the day, as you already know by now, is literature, disease, and mind. Now, living through a pandemic as we are right now, it is just natural that our thoughts will be preoccupied with disease. But in thinking of disease, our focus somehow seems to be entirely on health and safety measures or the condition of the economy. But you know, there is a very important existential dimension to the crisis we are facing as well. One that I think only a philosopher can properly elucidate. So we are very grateful and honored to have an eminent philosopher amongst us, Dr. Francesca Ferrando, who teaches at New York University and in the program of liberal studies, one of the founding members of New York program, New York post-human research group. She has published extensively on trans and post-humanism, but she's just not a successful scholar. She's a public intellectual. She has been awarded the prestigious Sainati Prize by the Italian president and actually has been named one of the top 100 creatives making change in the world by the US magazine Origin. In the history of TED Talks, she's the first one to give a talk on the topic of the post-human. Her latest publication, the book Philosophical Posthumanism, which has already made a mark in the field, has been published by Bloomsbury last year. And in fact, it is going to form a major part of the conversation that we are going to have today. And so without much ado, it's time now to welcome the philosopher herself, Dr. Ferrando. Namaskar. We are very happy to have you with us. I will now hand over to Oshi ji and request him to start the conversation. Thank you very much.
Okay, hello, Dr. Ferrando. Can I have you on the screen, please?
Yes, can you see me?
Yeah, I can see you. Hello, finally. How are you?
I am very well and I'm so happy to be here. And I would like to thank you, Azijit and Ritu Parna, and all the people who are connecting today. This is an amazing opportunity to talk about our existential condition. And I'm very, very, not only excited, but very honored to be invited for this event. Thank you so much, all of you. And thanks.
Thank you so much. It's our pleasure. So good evening and good morning also to Dr. Ferrando and everyone attending the discussion. And happy World Environment Day. So I think we have chosen an appropriate day to begin this. It's such a pleasure to finally have you here on the screen, yeah. And thank you for agreeing to be part of this discourse immediately. It was such an amazing surprise. So let's dive into the fire immediately. So Dr. Ferrando, what I want to begin with is, where do you place disease in the immediacy of the Anthropocene epoch? You know, how important do you think disease is in this Anthropocene epoch?
Thank you so much, Azijit, for this question. You're absolutely right. What we are experiencing is part of a process that can be and should be definitely located in a wider picture. The wider picture in geological terms can be defined as the Anthropocene. The Anthropocene is the era in which humans are recognized not only as part of the whole picture, but more importantly, as a geological force. As a species that has direct impact on many other species on the planet Earth, et cetera, et cetera. To the point, for instance, that we are at the moment in a sixth mass extinction, where thousands of species get extinct every year because of human action. So it's very important, your question is so right, to locate this condition that we are experiencing with COVID-19, and this is going to be one of many others. This is not the only one that we're going to be facing, including many other issues, hurricanes and tornadoes, and there is a lot going on. And this is something that we cannot see anymore as the human victim of diseases, victim of other species, victim of the grandiose energy of planet Earth. We are part of this. And for instance, a lot of the diseases that we are seeing, a lot of the viruses that we are seeing coming up along in the 21st century are connected directly to human actions in relation to non-human species, non-human animals. For instance, one of the most reputable theories about COVID-19 is precisely connected to the wet market. There are other theories out there. But this is just one of many other viruses that were introduced to the human species because of human actions. So I think it's very important to really locate, as you mentioned, this crisis in the in global terms and in relation to the Anthropocene. Because if we do not, we are just going to see more and more crises, not only related to viruses and diseases, but also, for instance, climate change, hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So in this sense, posthumanism really comes along as a philosophy that is not just something that we write about, is not just something that we do in academia. And this is why I also would like to thank Ritu Parna for mentioning the idea of public intellectuals. So I was just saying that it's absolutely fundamental not to see this crisis as the exception of a flourishing 21st century full of technological hope, which is sometimes the type of narrative that we find in transhumanism, but as one of the marks of the Anthropocene, in which we are playing a key role in development of a lot of outcomes that are coming from human interacting with non-human others and the biosphere in ways that have to be readdressed. And I think that, you know, there is a lot of trauma and a lot of tragedy coming with COVID-19, but there is also one side that Ritu Parna was addressing, the existential element, pushing us to face who we are, not only on an individual level, but also on a species level. And to me, when this started to happen, I really had to do that. I had to, you know, like I did a lot of meditation. I really had to stop, to silence myself, and to realize that we were getting into a really schizophrenic society, and everything was never enough. Not enough work, not enough jobs, not enough trips, not enough journeys, not enough conferences. Nothing was enough. We were like in this. You know, run towards what? Toward death in any case, because we're all going to die anyway, apart from COVID-19. So I think that this crisis that we are facing is also an existential awakening. And we really need to reconsider not only our individual location, but also us as a species, as beyond borders and nations, us as a species. What are we doing as a species here? That's a fundamental question. It's a political question, it's a philosophical question, it's an ethical question, and it's an existential question.
Right, Dr. Ferrando, thank you for your response. So now that I mentioned the Chinese open market also, so since the virus and so many others, and this one especially, in recent times have come from the animals, for example, in the Chinese open market, as you just rightly put, do you think that leaving the non-human others, respecting space, is perhaps the only solution now? You know, you are related and therefore you leave them alone. Whereas posthumanism always tells us, you know, inclusion. It's an inclusive category, right? An inclusive phenomenon. But do you think here, respecting distance or leaving them as they are is perhaps the better solution?
That's a wonderful question, Azigit. You know what? I would say absolutely yes. And I'll tell you a little more about this. I think that as a species, we need to really think of ourselves in relation to the planet. So we need to see how much land we've taken, how much trees we've cut, how many species are getting extinct because of our action. We need to realize how much more do we need, because it's never enough. We can cut all the trees of the world, and that would be very bad for us anyway, and kill all the other animals and find ourselves that we probably would have to locate some other planets, because this would be not a sustainable place anymore, because a lot of these species are allowing us to breathe. Think of the tree. They give us oxygen, and that's why we are alive, and that's why we can breathe and we can be healthy. So I think that at this point, we need to think of posthumanism also in design terms, in engineering terms, in architectural terms, in technological terms. And I think that it's enough of land that we have taken, enough of places that we have polluted. I think that at this point, we can, for instance, go to places that have been polluted because of human action and bring those back to maybe livable conditions. But absolutely, I think that the places that we have not touched upon yet, which are not many, but there are there, they should be considered like world parks, national parks, no humans, just give space for others, because this is a good balance for the human as well. So I'm getting more and more cynical when I see, you know, like people, oh, let's create an ecological community in the Goyen area and they cut the trees and they build more buildings enough. If we want to create an ecological community, let's go to a place that has been polluted by human action, cleanse that areas. There is a lot of study that has been done on this by engineers, for instance, how to bring back to ecological balance places that have been polluted by humans, because we are the people that have been polluting this planet the most in the last centuries. So I think that this is not just an ethical stand, this is a political stand. We need to have governments understanding that we cannot allow plants to be cut down anymore, and development at this point means ecological balance. It's for me, it's fundamental. So you're absolutely right. I think that at this point, once we are realizing not only how much damage we are doing to others, but to ourselves, because at the core of the whole issue is that we are not separated from others. We are related. For instance, you mentioned many of these diseases are coming from non-human animals. And the only reason is because we are devastating their areas. We are eating them. We are killing them. We are torturing them. So I think that a very important point that has to be understood with kindness, but has to be understood by politicians as well, is that what the best thing we can do at this point, if we're really talking about development, is not allowing more areas to be cut down and developed, which would be just means ecological tragedy. I mean, you just the Romans, Tacitus, who was an historian in ancient Rome, used to say, ubi desertum facent, pacem appellant, which means where they create the desert, they call it peace. And he was mentioning about humans, going around killing Romans, specifically going around killing all others and say, oh, this is peace. That's not a peace, you are just killing others. But now we can use this idea also for non-human others. And the development cannot be thought anymore of humans going to an area that was thriving with non-human life, killing all the animals and not killing all their habitat, and developing buildings for humans when we have a lot of space that we can restore. So, of course, there are humans that still need houses, and that's very important to keep in mind. Not every human being has a place to live. So, in that terms, we really need to think of, for instance, in Italy, there are beautiful areas, ancient areas that have been dismissed because people want to go to live in the cities. Now might change with COVID-19, but a lot of beautiful little towns, all made with, you know, stones and ancient material, they are completely abandoned. This place has to be at the center of our attention, not cutting down more trees and more land and destroying more ecological resources that are also our resources. And this is the selfish nature of the human, it's to bring to the conversation, because when we are in ecological balance, this is good for us. When we are in ecological disbalance, that is bad for us. Think of the high rates of cancer. When I was a child, if someone had a cancer, it was a tragedy. People would cry and it was a big deal. Now everyone has cancer. You ask, oh, what kind of cancer you have? It's so normal for people to have cancer, because the ecological devastation is also, of course, going back to the human. And I think of skin cancer, for instance, many other types of cancer. So going back to your question, Azijit, I think you're absolutely right. And this is a serious question. It's not just something that we can write in philosophy. That's why this is also a call for all of you. At this point, academics cannot be just writing. We need to be public intellectual with kindness, not with anger. I don't believe in anger. I think that you as a nation brought so much insight to the world. I'm thinking, for instance, the movement, Gandhi, the non-violent movement. How did you get your independence from England? It's incredible. So I think that this is a great, great lesson for all of us, all humans who are ever been born and whoever going to become coming to this world. So not talking about anger, but has to be very clear. We have to be clear about this. This is not something just we're writing about. This has to do with our life, our existence, our health. So thanks again for this question, Azijit.
Thank you so much for the response, Dr. Ferrando. For all those of you who do not know it yet, and Dr. Ferrando has written a brilliant book. It's called Philosophical Posthumanism. You should really buy it and go through it. So the next question is from your book. So there's a very there's a brilliant portion in your book where you write about the genetic mutation in human beings over the ages due to the consumption of human non-human milk, right? Non-human milk. So which of course led to domestication of animals and dairy farming. So do you feel the same way about meat consumption? I mean, has it led to another sort of mutation? So excessive animal consumption is perhaps responsible for the COVID-19 disaster. And one of the highly affected zones in the US has been the meat packing factories. So do you think somewhere we are also manipulated by meat consumption, like milk?
Thank you so much. Another great question. Again, my first reaction to your question, again, is absolutely yes. But maybe I shouldn't say absolutely. I should say yes. I've been, for instance, a vegetarian for ethical reasons since I was a younger teenager. Around 12 I started, and when I was 15, that was it. I became a full-on vegetarian. I know that a lot of people, for instance, in the post-human community are not vegetarian. They've been thinking about this question. If you're talking about rights for non-humans, if you're talking about non-human persons, if you're talking about non-human animals as persons, how come that after the conference you go to a restaurant and eat a big piece of steak or meat? That it's a question that I've been asking myself a long time, because I could not see how people could maybe write about you know, like non-human persons and then go to the main restaurant and offer food that had meat for everyone. So I came to this understanding of the movement and of also my location in this. Posthumanism can be seen and addressed in so many different ways. It can be something to write about. And in this sense, it's the split of the notion of philosophy itself. If you look, for instance, about, you know, like ancient Indian philosophers, philosophy, I think, you know, people connect it in the West to the Greek tradition. Indian tradition is actually much older than that. And when you look, for instance, at Indian philosophy, this is not something people were just writing. Actually, they were not writing at all. It was an oral tradition to change yourself, to understand existence in deeper ways, to understand that you are existence, that in that sense you are divine. This also was the case in many other traditions. For instance, there are many traditions in Greece also, in which philosophy was not just that you just were teaching your students, something that you would become, because it would change the way you exist. Philosophy itself, as a Greek notion, means the love for wisdom. Or some people like to change and say the wisdom of love, but still we are we're thinking about something that should not be just a job. Eventually, philosophy became something that is taught, which is great, became part of the academic tradition, which is great, but in that also became also something that can be just taught. So you can be a philosopher and just teach philosophy, but not applying those principles to your own life. So in that sense, I would say that in the posthumanist community, some people are taking philosophy, posthumanism, more as something that they teach, that they write about, that they think about, but it's not necessarily something that it changes their life. I'm of another school of thought. In this, for instance, I would like to mention also the Vashuch Banjari, who is also part of our audience. He's an incredible Indian teacher that is teaching in the US, in San Francisco. And we're also part of a kind of different strand of posthumanism, according to which posthumanism is changing your life. It's an existential approach, existential posthumanism. And in that sense, it becomes something that it allows you to ask questions about your daily routine. What about your food you eat? What about your thoughts you have? What about your interacting with others? So in that sense, going back to your question, as it did, I think that meat consumption, of course, should be addressed by the posthumanist community. Is that, first of all, is that ethical? Unless you have reasons for eating meat. Some people have specific diseases. I'm not talking about those cases. I'm not talking if you are starving. I'm not saying, I'm not going into exceptions. But in general, if you could eat other sorts of protein that are not involving killing some type of life, would you do it? Should you still do it? My answer to this question is not. And I think that the posthumanists should really reconsider their diet. And considering that, for instance, one of the causes strong ecological damage in the Amazon, for instance, is a lot of trees being cut down to create pastures for cows for the McDonald's to be eventually slaughtered and be eaten in also very unhealthy ways. So I think that this question is absolutely at the core of our discussion. But again, I would also like to clarify that I'm not generalizing my stand on posthumanism to everyone. I know that for some people, posthumanism is really just something that they enjoy intellectually. That's not the case for me. I think that my intellect, if it's separated from the way I live, is not helping me much. Because when I die, these changes have not applied to my being, my existing being. So in that sense, I got to the conclusion, through years of reflecting on this, that posthumanism is a way of existing. But again, just to clarify, not everyone involved in the posthumous community think this way, and it's fine. I love plurality, I love diversity, I love plurilogues, even more than dialogues. And this is why I would also like to recognize all these other positions. But I also have to be loyal to what I see existentially. And my, from my perspective, at this point, posthumanism is not only something that we can write about, has to change your life, and even more now with COVID-19, with all the crises that we're facing as a human species, we as academics at this point have to turn into butterflies, into public intellectuals. We need to really understand what's happening. It's not enough anymore to write academic papers, but that's what I feel, and I have to be loyal to my existential understanding.
Thank you, Dr. Ferrando. Taking the cue from you, the cue about the other. So you also mentioned in your book, you know, the compulsory separation between non-human others and human others, you know, prescribed by the humanizing process. You know, it is uncannily explicit now during the coronavirus, especially in a country like India. So we suddenly find the, you know, quote unquote, animalized others as migrant laborers out on the street. You know, they're returning home because, you know, there is not enough care where they used to work, and the government there is asking them to go back, and they're returning home, and the government, on the other hand, where they are going perhaps, is refusing to acknowledge their existence. So sight itself has become a problem, as if the animal is suddenly out of the zoo. And it's because of them that we have the virus, as if, you know, we are back to the Nazi era, perhaps. So do you think it's a classic instance of demonization and diseasing that we always use the virus as a sort of modus operandi, as a sort of, I don't know, operating factor for dominating the other?
Excellent question, Azizi. Thank you so much. I'm going to answer to this question in from a wide frame, because it's really important, your question, and we need to address it deeply and in details. So when we talk about posthumanism, I had eventually to come to a clear understanding what it was. Because on one side, we might talk later on about transhumanism, but transhumanism is a different movement, and it's very clear what they want, which is human enhancement. And so people know what is transhumanism about. When you talk about posthumanism, there was a lot of confusion. What is posthumanism? Why is that relevant? What people want? So I eventually come with these very clear layers. There are three of them, and are very much answering your question. The first one is we want post/humanism, which means a real, sincere understanding and acknowledgement of humanity as a plurality, not human as a singular notion that can be concentrated or clarified through one specific type of human, which historically, if you think of the history of sexism, classism, ethnocentrism, colonialism, has been white, male, Western, Northern European, etc., etc., etc. So in that sense, we understand through this first layer that the human as a category has never been one. That the human as a species has been more of a process of humanization. In this process, some humans have not been considered human at all. There are many cases, for instance, the case of classism that you are mentioning now, and definitely with in any type of crisis, can be economic crisis, can be a biological crisis, can be ecological crisis, can be a disease, you see immediately a long ancient tradition of racism, ethnocentrism, classism coming in. And that's, I would say, global. the foreign becomes the bad one, the one that is not directly connected to you become the issue, the scapegoat, the cause of the problem. And this is not just India, this is happening everywhere. In Italy, with Italians, with non-Italians, Europeans with Italians, in the United States, with, for instance, people from Asia. Even myself, I relocated, I was in New York during the crisis. At the beginning, I had to relocate in the south, and even just having an accent, people were looking strangely. Are you bringing the disease? So wherever you are not the norm, you become someone who become the scapegoat. And this is like, we have seen this with COVID-19 globally, but this is something that we have seen in the history of the human over and over and over. And I think one of the issue is very ancient. It can be traced at least as ancient as the beginning of cities, the Neolithic, when people started to define themselves in relation to a stable group. In this sense, I really think that the problem here is seeing the human and teaching humans through identities. Now you are, as a young child, you don't have an identity, you are everything. You ask a young child what you want, this or that, they say both. Who are you? They don't know the answer because they are everything. Then with socialization, especially the way we've been taught about society, is that you need to categorize yourself very clearly. Are you female? Are you male? Are you white? Are you black? Are you hetero? Are you gay? Are you Indian? Are you non-Indian? Like, all these categories become something that you need to embrace on some level and choose from, or not even choose from, accept. This is when a deep work has to be done in philosophical terms, educational terms, when we, from day one, with young children, we teach them that that you are in relation with diversity, which is also your own diversity. Because if you think of yourself when you were a young child and yourself now, you are different. Of course there is a relation, but there is also a relation between you and all the human others that are out there. So in that sense, Azijit, I think it's very important, your question, because you're addressing something that is, I would say, the first layer of posthumanism. Because some people like more exotic trends of posthumanism, they go, they jump to the artificial intelligence, they jump to the non-human, without realizing that there is no way you can jump to non-human diversity if you do not address first human diversity, and if you do not acknowledge human diversity as part of the species, because this is an evolving species, we are constantly changing. So in that sense, Azijit, the first layers that I would really address is posthumanism. Understanding the human as a plurality in which we understand that we are we are all different, and we need to acknowledge diversity with deep respect, with deep understanding of the fact that we are part of this picture. And of course it's deeper than that, because if you think of perspectivism, think of your own location, the way you are seeing the screen right now, and we are in this together, and seeing the screen in a completely different way. But we are manifesting this moment with all these other 168 people with us right now. And everyone will have a different but related experience of this amazing conference that we are holding right now. So in that sense, we need to address the human as a plural, humans, post-humanism. This is it. And then we're post-anthropocentrism. Enough of seeing the human as the most exceptional, the best, the most intelligent, all this narrative, grand narrative, created anthropocentrism is bad for humans. Human centrism is bad for humans, as much as racism is bad for humans, and sexism is bad for humans, and ethnocentrism is bad for humans. So that's the second layer. It's important. They're not in a hierarchical order, but they have to be there at the same time, really have a posthumanist approach. And the third one, which India can teach so much, thinking about all the philosophies that have been developed, is post-dualism. Because on one level, if you go beyond racism, beyond ethnocentrism, beyond classicism, et cetera, et cetera, but if you still keep a dualistic approach in mind, and I'm talking about a rigid dualism, I'm not talking about, for instance, the fluid dualism of the Tao, then we're going to have the same issues. The future might be AI against humans. I mean, you're always going to have this dualistic approach. So we need to go to the core of how we teach humans to become humans. And I think identity has to be really re-envisioned. And we can be Hindu and Muslim and Christian and atheist, whatever it is, but we need to understand that that's, it's a location that we take in the big picture, which is a beautiful location. We are flourishing a specific view in relation to others. So in that sense, post-dualism is really important. So not seeing the other as the enemy, not see the other as this absolute other that eventually create genocide, et cetera, et cetera, but seeing the other as enriching your perspective, even because they have a different view than yours. So that even through the diversity, you can really expand and see more in what you are seeing, which is absolutely beautiful. And so are all the other people, all the other colors, all the other genders and nations and the diversity that is flourishing through the manifestation of existence.
Thank you, Dr. Ferrando. Let's shift to technology a little bit. So the way I understand posthumanism, it's a very sensitive balance between technology and ethics. So in transhumanism and otherwise too, technology always comes with appendage advancements. Are the posthumanist scholars also asking for a check on technological growth? Because history shows that responsible or effective use of technology is far too utopian. I understand interrelationality, but hasn't technology always been about extraction and appropriation rather than being cohabitational? How do you negotiate between bio-war and bioethics then?
Thanks so much, Azipit, for your question. Very important. So I mentioned that one way to make clear what posthumanism was, it was through these three layers of posthumanism, post-anthropocentrism, and post-dualism. Another way that I use to explain in even more clear ways to people who maybe do not come from academia, and there is a lot of interest on this topic from everyone. So it doesn't have to be intellectual, doesn't have to be scholars. There are people who, you know, maybe vendors or maybe anything, and they ask you, but what is posthumanism? So one way that I've been using to explain it in even a clearer ways what it is, because we should always be able to explain even to a child what is, for instance, posthumanism or anything else. So if we do not know how to do it, it means that it's not clear in our head. So I came to this description, which is, of course, is very basic, but it's still very true. I describe it as a way to understand the human, as an open way to understand the human in relation, for instance, to ecology and technology. So on one side, we are relocating the human on planet Earth, as we mentioned in the first question that you have asked about the Anthropocene. We are part of a species, part of a planet, part of an era, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. On the other side, we are talking also in material terms of the human in relation, for instance, to technology. Of course, the question here is how you define technology. Because you're right that some technology have been used in very human-centric, anthropocentric ways. A lot of technology has been used to devastate ecological areas, et cetera, et cetera. In that sense, I would say that I would rather like to a philosopher who is considered a great philosopher and not a great human being, as I mentioned, that sometimes is the case, who is Heidegger. According to Heidegger, technology is going back to the Greek term, which is techne, is a way of revealing. Say one more time, way of revealing. Now, I like to bring this notion in existential terms. So I like to think of technology not just as our computer, as our cell phone, laptop, whatever it is, but really as techne, as anything that really allows us to manifest existence in different ways, to the point that a lot of people say, well, technology comes with fire, and fire comes with cooking. And some people say, you know, like cooking was at the core of the development of technology. So in that sense, of course, it depends how you define technology. But I would like to see technology again, not as something that we are using, so not as a tool, because as a tool, it reflects only the human biases. So you're right, because we have been behaving in very anthropocentric ways. Technology also has been used in very anthropocentric ways. But now, if we do not see technology as a tool, but if we see technology as a way of revealing, as a way of manifestation of existence, so Brahman, to go again to the Hindu tradition, in that sense, it becomes something that goes beyond the human. In that sense, it becomes something that we need to fully recognize, to fully dignify, to fully acknowledge in with dignity, with existential dignity. In this sense, I like to think of technology. In this sense, I like to think of AI as partaking in the existential quest. And in this sense, I also would like to bring, of course, to the discussion eco-technology, for instance. A technology has to be also rethought in ecological terms. Most laptops come with minerals, for instance. They come from the Republic of Congo, and they are mined in rebel-controlled areas, causing disruption in human life, non-human life, natural resources. So when we think of technology, I would like to think of technology not in separation from ecology, because again, all the material that we use to create technology come from planet Earth anyway, but also not in separation from the human, not so much because it's a tool of the human, but because it's co-creating existence. Even the way we think of ourselves in the 21st century is different from the way people were thinking of themselves 100 years ago, 200 years ago, and so forth. The way, for instance, I had the experience of flying I tried many years ago this platform, which at the time was used, I think it was called Virtual Life or something. But I tried to, I had an avatar, and I flied around, I flew. And I remember this experience of being very revealing, in the sense that I was not physically flying, but I had an experience that I never had before, maybe in my dreams. What I'm trying to say is that, and again, let's go back to the Hindu tradition, the idea of the consciousness is not just when we are awakened, it's related to all of our experiences during our dreams, during our sleep states, and also during our virtual experiences. These are going to become part of our consciousness. So there is no way we can think of technology in separation as a tool, because this tool is changing the way we see existence, is changing the way we are relating with existence, and is changing the way existence itself is manifesting, because technology is a manifestation of Brahman, or is a manifestation of existence. So in that sense, come to an end to your beautiful question, technology can be used in anthropocentric ways, but that issue comes with the human perspective, the human habit of taking anthropocentric for granted. So we need to reflect and change our habits of existence, our individual habits, in order to see different ways that we embrace technology. But we need to acknowledge technology fully, existentially, not just as a tool, as a way of a manifestation that is changing the way we are existing, that is changing the ontorealm, ontological, the realm of being.
Thank you, Dr. Ferrando. Since you mentioned the Brahman, let's shift to spiritualism a little bit, because you also mentioned that spiritualism and strictly not religiosity can be used as a resistance in contexts where essentialism configures hierarchical categories. Are you proposing a broader culture of spiritualism to replace religion in our present times? Do you consider post-humanism to be a kind of spirituality which upholds the interrelation of inner and outer worlds? Also, do you assign a superior function to literature or any other art form here, which can be collaborated with spiritualism and used by post-humanism?
Thank you so much, Azizit. Another wonderful question. I also would like to mention on this, yeah, that I have an article which is freely available if you go to myacademia.edu profile, which is called "Humans Have Always Been Posthuman: A Spiritual Genealogy of the Posthuman," which was also published by Debashish Banerjee in a book published by Springer India. Now, you're absolutely right. I think that there is a strong connection here, which we may want to underline or may not. The point with spirituality is that it's seen by the academic tradition with some type of uneasiness. The uneasiness comes with the wrong relation that academics have seen between spirituality and religion, because a lot of people think that spirituality is just a synonym for religion, and that's not true. Nothing wrong with religion, but they are two different things. Now, if we look at the history of spirituality, which really transcend any specific group, because all kind of human groups have been having spiritual experiences. Now, if you look from this perspective, humans on some level have always been post-human, because the spiritual approach is when you really realize that there are not dichotomies. There may be some type of dualism or duality. Again, if you think through the Tao, also if you think through the Upanishads, in which sometimes duality is mentioned in, again, in a fluid form. But most of the cases, you're thinking of a continuous evolution of diversity. Think of biological realm itself. Think of how evolution works. We're constantly changing. And for instance, evolution does not move towards complexity, but moves towards diversification. So it's not that we are becoming better, we are just constantly diversifying, because we are constantly adjusting, for instance, to the environment, and the environment also is constantly adjusting to us, because we are in this entanglement, in this direct fluid relation that is making who we are. Now, going back to your question, on one side, my first answer, again, I would be absolutely yes. But I also want to acknowledge that for some people who have been trained and seen spirituality as a synonym for religion, these also have been considered something problematic. So in general, I may want to use the term existential, not so much as existentialist, because then you go into a specific tradition, which is existentialism, 50s in Europe, but existential in the sense that if you look from an existential perspective, and that's again, for me, the Upanishads are very much philosophical, Of course, they're also spiritual, but I think it's a kind of language that can be really understood universally. So I do think that spirituality brings a lot to the conversation, and this is why we need to acknowledge it. Also because spirituality has been the only tool that some humans had in their relation with society. Think, for instance, of the case of slaves. There are many cases of slavery. Slavery is very ancient. I can bring a more of a modern example, for instance, with the United States, but there are, again, slavery has been very ancient. In very ancient times, we have been slavery all over the world. But for instance, if you think of the United States, we have a lot of archives demonstrated that, for instance, African Americans use spirituality to reconnect to everything in a situation, in a society in which they were dehumanized. They were murdered and tortured and discriminated against. And this idea of being connected allowed, gave them sanity, gave them the desire to exist, and the understanding that that you can be in prison, you can be tortured, you can be raped, you can be anything, but no one in the end can really touch your soul, because you are the only one who have access to your own soul. Session. On the other end, because posthumanism has been developed at the moment, at least in academia, I would suggest to be a little aware of the fact that some people do see spirituality as a synonym for religion, and they are skeptical. Nothing against with religion, but of course with religion come some dogmas. So I have the truth and the other one doesn't have the truth. Doesn't have to be that way. There is a lot of interfaith dialogue at the moment, which is wonderful. But some people see religion as the ultimate truth and see their religion as the only truth. That's when we have some problem. Because one thing is that you find truth in a specific religion. The other thing is that this religion is the only truth, and you force others to believe in what you believe. That's, for me, is an issue. Because we need to recognize diversity, and we need to recognize that the divine can be seen and felt in so many different ways. Because, for instance, even the way we imagine the divine and we see the divine is a personal experience, come from our background and our experience of existence, which is all very different. So in that sense, I would advise, if people want to look more into spirituality, absolutely yes, beautiful. You're going to find so much truth there that is so much related to post-dualism, and we can learn so much from the realm of spirituality. On the other side, be aware that the language you want to use has to be also very much acknowledging the fact that spirituality on some level is an experience that has been historically connected to specific religious traditions, which is fine, but just to make sure that we all come from an understanding of we all are in this together. We are all manifesting in this dimension. And in that sense, we all are having, we all can have this spiritual or existential enlightenment, understanding of existence. So yeah, I love the realm of spirituality to look more into, to understand more post-dualism. On the other side, I'm writing my second book and I'm going more into the term existential to avoid people who come from different traditions, more connected to, for instance, academic philosophy, to feel a little threatened by using this notion. So I think existential can also help.
Thank you, Dr. Ferrando, for this brilliant explication. From spiritualism, let's shift a little bit to fatalism. So do you support Donna Haraway's assertion that we must see ourselves as post-human compost? So humus, as she says, nourishing the earth. Is this too fatalistic a view? I mean, are we really ready to see ourselves as decaying matter, assisting the plant world? Though life and death, I know, in post-humanism are interacting or interacting categories. Do you think we are ready for this kind of fatalism?
Thank you so much, Azijit. So let's, again, this is a very important question. So let's bring it from a deeper perspective. And let's bring Donna Haraway from the beginning with her Cyber Manifesto that was published in 1985, or a Manifesto for Cyber. It became so well known that some people call it a Cyber Manifesto, some people call it a Manifesto for Cyber, which was very important in the 90s on one level to acknowledge technology as something that we are already, and on the other level, to acknowledge us as hybrids, as chimeras, with its own limit. I think, for instance, of Vandana Shiva, another excellent Indian scholar, who came with some really good criticism of the notion of the cyborg as well. Going back to your question, once you have the cyborg, everything is mixed, then what about, for instance, non-human others? Can you respect them without, you know, for instance, allowing the notion of the hybrid, bringing to the conversation all other type of discourses, for instance, GMOs, et cetera, et cetera. It was a very important criticism from Vandana Shiva. Now, yes, you're right. Donna Haraway eventually developed her discourse through the field of non-human animals, animal studies, and eventually she came to with a beautiful book that came a couple of years ago about the Cthulhu scene, the idea that we are humans, that we are, that we should see ourselves as compost. Now, and she's also critical of the notion of the post-human because she sees it as, on some level, as a disruption, I would say. I would say that the two things are not at war with each other. I think that I can see myself as compost because I hope I'm going to be. I would love the idea of being fully compost because of hygienical reason we don't do this as a society anymore. It used to be the case, once someone would die, would just go directly on the bare earth and would flourish and give life to others, worms and plants and the earth. I think it's absolutely beautiful. It's not so much the case anymore because of hygienical reasons. But I think that, of course, on one side, it's very important from a materialistic standpoint to see ourselves that way. And that also helps us addressing death, because there is an issue, especially, for instance, in some countries. I think that maybe India is a little exception. I know that, for instance, in some cities, there is much more recognition between life and death. But, for instance, in the US, death become a taboo. No one talks about it. People who die disappear from anything. And now with COVID-19, this taboo has been disrupted because now people are dying and people that you know are dying. And yeah, maybe you're not going to see the bodies because you are not allowed to funerals, but now you are aware of your own death. Now, this can be, should be always part of our existential scenario. For instance, I can think of Heidegger, but many others, who, for instance, say that death gives meaning to life because the fact that we are dying allows us to make us our to make life our own project. In that sense, before I even knew about Heidegger as a young person, I would always think when I wasn't sure about what should I do in my life, should I do this or that, should I study this or that, I would always think, what if I die, let's say, not even tomorrow, or maybe tomorrow, and I look myself in the mirror, What is the thing that I should have done and I didn't do? What is the thing that stopped me to look at me, myself in the mirror and say, are you kidding me? Why didn't you do that? And that the notion of death really helped me in my life to always be authentic to myself, to my own vision, and also to understand what was my vision. Now with COVID-19, when it started, and I had family members who had it in Italy, I'm based in the United States, but all of a sudden you realize that someone you deeply love could die, but that you can die, because eventually, you know, started to spread in Italy and eventually spread in the United States as well. To me, was now I say it worked because I am in a place where things are better in Italy, things are also better here. On some level, we are still on the same, you know, it's not that anything has changed, but people are being more careful. But let's say that the idea of death really brought me back to a deep understanding. And I would really realize that we need to be fully loyal to our existence, fully loyal to our life. Not think that we have infinite amount of time, because we're going to die. Maybe it's one day from now, maybe 1 week, maybe 1 month, maybe 10 years, maybe 30 years, or maybe 800 years, like the transhumanists want. Doesn't matter. And the notion of death should always be present with us, but in a generative way. Not to make you afraid, but to push you to flourish as that existential being that you are, because it's not easy to exist. It's not easy to be born. Think about the complexity of actually being generated by parents to be brought to life, to be here today. That's not an easy process. The fact that we are here is very precious. So what are we going to do with this? And we are the only one who know what we can do with this. We are the only one who have access to our inner, deeper voice. We are the only one. And death is that push for us to see, push for us to realize, what am I doing? Why am I here? What is really relevant? So in that sense, Azijit, yes, we are compost. We are not only compost. And this idea, it's true, but should not be seen as a dichotomy. I am, you know, I'm a compost and not a posthumous. Hathaway is going a little more, okay, I'm just compost. I feel that I am that and I'm much more, and I am I'm an open notion, including compost. And hopefully, I could be compost. Unfortunately, in many countries, we cannot be compost anymore, but I would love that.
Thank you, Dr. Ferrando. Since we're discussing compost, recently there was an article in The Guardian regarding the absence of images of dead bodies in America. You know, psychologists are of the opinion that this has led to incomplete grief, where you cannot cry over your you know, beloved's dead body or someone, a relative's dead body. And that's on the one hand, and a total lack of awareness among people, to the extent that 21% of Americans have already said that they don't need the vaccine to COVID-19. You know, death has been condensed into data and graphs. So do you think it's time to think about the responsibility and character of dead bodies, that they are not just silent structures, but assigned with performativity, performative potentials of their own? Also, I'm keeping in mind the rejection of alive dead dualism in post-humanism. So do you think dead bodies should be also reconsidered as a performative agents?
Thank you so much for your question, Azijit. It is a very important question, also very delicate question. And yes, let's address it. I don't know if I have the final answer to this, but I want to bring some food for thoughts here. I think that on one side, the way that society was going, at least in the United States, I know that some areas, for instance, think of Benares in the India, is very different. I know that in Benares, you have the experience of seeing life and death as constantly merging with each other, and seeing bodies and ashes and flowers. And you know, so this is an experience that I think that is very real and brings you back to your material existence and make you think. In the United States, for instance, and also some level is in Italy, but Italy maybe less, is different. For instance, in the United States, even the topic of death, it was completely erased. You would not talk about death. And if you did, people would see as something sad, you should not mention, why are we thinking about this? And then when people die, it's almost like become more of an individual experience of dealing with that. I think that that was not healthy. And on some level, COVID-19 brought us back to the realization that we're all going to die, no matter what. Even if we're going to go into radical life extension, like some transhumans want, I'm not necessarily against it. I don't think that it's going to add too much to the existential experience, but it might happen. Even so, people still are going to die. So I think that death has to be part of our dealing with life. And I think, for instance, of many Buddhist meditation that really ask you to think of yourself as dead, because that allow you to really see yourself as alive. But in that sense, let's go back more specifically to the question of the body, which was your question, is very important. I can tell you from a personal experience that something that deeply changed me as a person was to see the dead body of my grandmother. I deeply loved her. And I was with her every day for 1 month before she died. The day that she died, I didn't want to go there. I was 2-3 hours just roaming around. I was at the time in Italy. I didn't want to see her dead. I just could not accept it. Eventually I went, and I remember taking her hand in my hand, and her hand was completely pale, so pale that I'd never seen anything like that. And I took it in my hand, within 1 month, I start to have this issue with my hands, which we call Raynaud, not having circulation in the hand. That allowed me to start a journey, which I will be always grateful for instance, of yoga. That was many years ago. I started to do yoga because of that. And it really, I became a very spiritual person because I started a deep search in myself. And eventually Raynaud also went away. But what I'm trying to say is that the relation with seeing, with touching, with acknowledging that body can be a deep experience. In that sense, I think that just erasing this experience from the human experience is absolutely wrong. I also want to mention that, of course, there are layers, you know. Maybe, you know, young children, maybe you want to wait to expose them to the relation and you know, like in a full experience of a dead body of someone who you love, or maybe not. But I think that it's something that we absolutely need to reconsider. And again, in my experience, it's something that it really brought into me a deep change, having the chance of seeing her alive and also dead. It definitely changed something deeply in me. So I would say that I don't know again if I have the right answer to this. I definitely know that bodies cannot just be, erased from the conversation. I know the reason why they were erased from the conversation at the moment with COVID-19, it was with the fear of spreading the disease. But I also know some people who had the experience of having people love to them, dying, and not be able to see them, to touch them, to say goodbye. They are deeply traumatized because of this. They feel guilty because of that. And so we need to also understand that some people are really going, they're really experiencing a very traumatic time because they were not able to connect with their loved ones once they were dead. For instance, I bring an example in Italy. There was this man, his father died. He could not go to the hospital, anything, and he could only see from the window the car that passed by. He thought that was the car bringing his dead to the cemetery. And this person is still dealing with this trauma. So definitely I think that just erasing the bodies, you know, it's something that we need to reconsider. Of course, we need to consider many other aspects, like, you know, the spreading of the disease through funerals, through bodies, et cetera, et cetera. But I also think that if people are ready, people are mature enough, the connection, seeing the dead body of someone you love, it's very important.
Thank you, Dr. Fernando. So do you think that it's an inherent problem in humans of not referring to themselves as, let's say, bioevolutionary animals, but rather as products of a particular historical time and political space? You know, the trouble with the anthropological machine. So my question is, why is the environment reduced to mere aesthetics? That is perhaps, not the right way to put it, but the aestheticization of environment is a huge problem, if I understand correctly.
Thank you so much, Azizi, for this question. So you're very right. for many centuries, if not maybe my millennia. I'm getting very interested in the very beginning of the civilization, Mesopotamia, Neolithic time. And I would really invite a lot of new incredible people who are connected today to also look at the history, for instance, of the Paleolithic, like before humans started to settle in urban areas, in whatever it was called, civilization, through the beginning of writing, et cetera, et cetera. But you're absolutely right. Definitely for many centuries, the humans have developed a narrative of a nature slash culture. And for instance, we have a very good example with, for instance, Greek society, in which nature was seen as barbarian, as risky, as wild. And on the other side, you would have culture as civilization, as also as made, as also as Greek. So this also separation between nature and culture was not just non-human versus human, but some humans versus non-human and versus non-human others. Some humans versus some other humans and non-humans. For instance, in Greek, the notion of anthropos, which means human in Greek, was specifically connected to speaking Greek, to being part of paideia, which was education, and many civilizations that were not Greek were considered barbarian, were not considered anthropos. Egyptians and the Greeks really appreciate Egyptian culture, but they would see the Egyptians, the Persians, Phoenicians, etc., etc., as barbarian. So in that sense, you're right, there has been this separation between nature and culture, and in this separation, in many societies, culture was seen as the plus, and nature was seen as the manus, the human, again, in a hierarchical way, according to which some humans more, other humans less, were seen as part of culture, so superior to human nature, to nature. And you can see this in really many traditions, really across the globe, even for instance, in the notion of reincarnation, rebirth, Hindu Buddhist tradition, the idea that if you reincarnate or if you're reborn as a human, is considered something good. That's also, we can see a trace of anthropocentrism there. So I would say that this has to be fully reconsidered. We cannot see ourselves anymore in separation from nature. We cannot see us anymore as better than other animals, which doesn't mean that we should dismiss human life. There are some people, for instance, who are calling for the extinction of the human. For instance, Patricia McCormack with the A Human. I'm not at all into that strand either, because for me, the human is not a plus, but it's not a minus either. The human is part of the manifestation. So it doesn't mean that now the human get extinct, things are going to go good. I don't believe in that. Posthuman for me means that we need to readdress the human in relation to all the other species as part of the picture, not again as the plus, but neither as the minus. So in that sense, for some years, now there are also some issues with that, but for some years coming from, again, Donna Haraway, that you rightly mentioned some questions before, in the posthumanist tradition, you would not write anymore nature, culture, you would write nature, culture together as one term to really show that nature is culturally affected and culture is a natural process. So that nature and culture are not separated and have to be addressed in conjunction. In this sense, you can also, for instance, think of the history of biology. Think, for instance, of epigenetic manifestation. Think, for instance, how culture is constantly transforming, changing biology itself. So we cannot see anymore nature and culture separated, which doesn't mean either that, as again, bringing Vandana Shiva, now the human can do anything because we are cyborg and everything is cyborg, and she's right, we have to be careful also with that. But it's very important, absolutely, to see us part of the picture, in that sense, also recognition of diversity as enriching our life in so many levels, including from a health perspective. We're talking about disease here, being in a balanced planet is also bringing balance and health to our own life. In fact, health, and I'm talking about the English term, come from ancient Germanic to whole, to mean whole. The whole means relation to the whole wider picture. So you're absolutely right, Ajit. This separation between nature and culture is very problematic. One solution, which I don't think is the final solution, was, for instance, through Donna Haraway to write nature culture together and think in natural cultural terms, but I also want to be aware, through Vandana Shiva, the fact that this also doesn't mean that we can just do anything, because anything is a cyborg anyway. So very, you know, really thinking in terms of diversity with real honesty and real dignity. So that's very, very important. And of course, we can expand, you know, to so many other topics, you know, GMOs and all these other things. You know, what about the plant that are, you know, like spreading seeds that have been genetically modified to areas that were wild? And now, you know, so we need to really reconsider what we are doing from an ecological perspective, technological perspective, and existential ontological perspective.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ferrando. And since we have reached almost the end of our conversation, let us end with your solution of the post-human multiverse. Could you guide us, you know, through this intriguing sampling of the post-human multiverse? And this should be my last question, I promise.
Thank you so much, Azishit. Actually, it's very interesting you're asking that, because there was an article that just came out this week on National Geographic, actually talking about the scientific reality of possible other dimensions. We're talking about physics, and we're talking about the multiverse. Now, what I do with my book is a journey that starts from the very beginning of how we define ourselves in, for instance, a nomenclature, where does the notion of the human even come from, to a biological process, what about the human species as in biological terms, or what about the species itself? And then I go into physics, and I go to the hypothesis of the multiverse. Now it's interesting because they're actually saying, well, it's not really just an hypothesis, apparently really it's a reality. But it doesn't matter if it's a hypothesis or in a reality. I think the point of the multiverse, for me, in philosophical terms, is really extraordinary. And it's something that, you know, like as a comparison, we can think, for instance, of the rhizome that was brought as a metaphor by Deleuze and Guattari back in the 80s, which was really important to understand the network, the online existence, the internet, and the rhizome. Think of turmeric. Many other type of form of life, ginger. These form of life, they are not linear. You can take a piece of turmeric, put it in the earth or in water first, and they're going to spread and keep existing and being and grow. The same goes with ginger, for instance. So Deleuze and Guattari were saying, well, this is our experience. Life is not linear, and this metaphor was brought to the internet. Think when you navigate online, one link is going to take you to the next, and 1 hour later you find yourself in some awkward reading about, who knows, the multiverse, and you had no idea you were going to end up there. So in that sense, is rhizomatic. Now, the multiverse for me is as precious as something like the rhizome in the 80s to understand, for instance, the online experience. Because the multiverse for me is a metaphor which also could apply to a real physical reality. Again, National Geographic just came out with an article all about this, saying, okay, this is not just an hypothesis. But even if it was just an hypothesis, the point is that let's play a game. And I love philosophical hypotheses, and I love philosophical games. I love Nietzsche. Friedrich Nietzsche did change my life when I was 16 years old. And I studied Das Spock Zarathustra, and I love his metaphor and philosophical game of the recurrence of the same. And he asks you, and I'm going to bring this because it might be helpful to all of you. He asks, what if your life was going to come back exactly the same forever and ever and ever? Would you do exactly what you did in your life? Would you speak the way you spoke to others? Would you act with others the way you did? Would you do exactly the same? Would you accept that life? Exactly the same. And he's on this, he's not, you know, there is something that of course resonates with the yogas in the Hindu tradition, but he's saying something a little different. He said exactly the same. So not just a spiral, a cycle, exactly the same. So he says, if you would accept your life exactly the same, the way it is forever and ever and ever, you are the Übermensch. which has been wrongly translated, as I said, superhuman. Superman is more the superhuman, the overhuman. In that sense, you are taking full responsibility of your life, because your life is the best work of art that you can ever imagine. Now, in that sense, I'm going to push this to the multiverse from an ethical perspective. And I'm going to bring ethics and physics at the same time. And I say, what if in the physics hypothesis of the multiverse, which again, it is one of the only way we can explain quantum physics, and has, again, has been now brought to science that it actually might be a reality. But what if you are co-constituting in the way you exist through your vibrational range? So again, let's go back to quantum physics. Let's go back to string theory. And let's think of us in material sense as this compost of strings that is constantly reconstituting ourselves every microsecond. In this sense, we are a network of alliances, an epicenter of connections, a center of connection in the existential realm that is constantly changing. Now, what if through the way we exist, the food we eat, the thoughts we have, what if we are constantly constituted and connected to a specific vibrational range? What does it mean in ethical terms? What does it mean from an existential perspective? That we, again, are not just existing in one dimension, but we are coexisting and co-creating other dimensions through, again, our vibrational range. So this I bring to the book as an hypothesis, because I'm not a scientist. I mean, I am a philosophical, I do science in philosophical terms, but I don't want to go to the scientific term. Again, now National Geographic then came with bringing a lot of science to the conversation, say, well, actually, this might be a reality. But my point doesn't matter if it's reality or not. What if, again, I love philosophical hypotheses, I love thought games, and how much a thought game can enrich your life. And again, to me, the philosophical game that Nietzsche brought in Das Spock Zarathustra and in some other texts, that is the Terror Recurrence, the game that we did before, did change my life. I remember studying that when I was 16, and this stayed with me forever. I constantly ask myself, would I live this life again and again and again? And if the answer is not, I have to change something. The answer is yes, I'm doing what I should be doing to really manifest the life that I want to see. So in that sense, I do like the multiverse, not only as an amazing hypothesis in physics, but also as a thought game. What if we think of us as a constantly changing, shifting network of alliances, energies, and physics, and we are constantly connecting to a different vibrational range, and we are also helping co-manifesting all these other layers of existence. So it's a fascinating way for me to end the book, because it's not an end, it's a beginning. And so thanks for asking this question, Asijit.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Ferrando. Now the forum is open for questions. Can I have the names, please? And I think we can take, we have 15 minutes or maybe 10 minutes for questions. So we can take three or four questions maybe. There are so many names. There are around 28, 29 people who want to ask questions. There is someone called P. Cooper. Is he or she, I don't know, is there? He's asked a question on law and legislation. If he's not there, then I'll go to someone else. Can Oishik Maiti ask a question, please? Switch on the audio and the video and ask the question.
Yes.
Yeah,
you, yeah. Thank you, Dr. Ferrando, for the very enriching lecture. This is Oishik Maiti. I'm a third year English honors student from the Heritage College, Kolkata. And my question to you would be, how does women's writing in the representation of illness resist the pathologization of gender difference as visible in the Eurocentric male-defined literary canon? Thank you.
Thank you so much for your question. Because the connection was a little disrupted, let me ask you if I understood correctly. Your question is about gender and posthumanism and also literature. Sorry, because I couldn't hear so well. I could understand gender, but I couldn't understand the whole question.
Yes, ma'am. How does women's writing in the representation of illness resist the pathologization of gender difference, as we see in the male-defined literary canon?
Thank you so much. It's an excellent question. Yeah, you're absolutely right. If we read, for instance, we need to reconnect culture, we need to reconnect literature. And when I say literature, we really, really expand from mythology, philosophy, literature, poetry, narrative, et cetera, et cetera. So literally in this sense, we need it also to connect it to a biological history. In fact, when we look, for instance, at the history of many of the fields that I just mentioned, the ones that were recorded were mostly coming from authors that were embodied as male. Now, when we start to read other stories, we're also going to find other perspectives. In this sense, I am very passionate about asking all of you to try to be brave enough to rewrite the human canon. What I mean by that? I mean the fact that most of the writings that we study, most of the philosophers that we study, most of the ideas that we study have been developed by people who were biologically, for instance, male. And not only, you can really add a lot of layers here, but the question was from gender, so definitely gender is really important. Now, when we look, for instance, at the other stories that we do not usually study, and I bring back the Paleolithic because it's very fascinating. So when you look, for instance, at the Paleolithic, when we talk about the Paleolithic, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of years. But we always dismiss as some era that is primitive, is barbarian, we don't need to study. We study from the late Neolithic on with the invention of writing. But interestingly enough, we study, usually the first mythology that is studied, for instance, is Gilgamesh. When we don't study the real first mythology that we have, which was Inanna. Inanna is the first mythology ever written or ever brought into writing, because we know all these mythologies, for instance, in the Indian tradition, were oral. Eventually, they come as a writing tradition. Inanna, for instance, very interesting, because in Inanna, we have a female hero, which is the divine, and is the Trinity, is the goddess, which really means the god, because at the time, there were not really notion of god as male, as the goddess of the sky, the god to the below, to also become the goddess of earth and the underworld. Now, I think it's very interesting that when we study, we don't just study. We are not just exposed to any kind of knowledge. We are exposed to some knowledge that is considered knowledge in that specific society. So, for instance, we grow up thinking, for instance, that the first mythology we have is, or at least in some countries, it studies Gilgamesh. Yes, there are many more, also again, in the tradition, Mahabharata, et cetera, et cetera. But I think that it's very important to understand that the culture is redefining its culture by recognizing what is culture itself. So in that sense, I'm at a point where I think we are ready to be able to write in different ways, to write in ways that are gender aware, species aware, race aware, ethnicity aware, class aware, to write in a way that we are re-envisioning the myth of this, whatever you call it, posthuman species, or call it the way you want. I'm not attached to posthumanism either, the term, but we need to be brave enough to recognize all the beauty that comes with ancient knowledge, all the beauty that comes with the history of the human, but also recognize that a lot of that comes with limits, comes with the limit of the culture recognizing itself as culture. In that sense, I think, for instance, the Paleolithic is really interesting, because if you look at the 90% of the figurines that come in the Paleolithic, they are all female. But we don't study that, because envisioning the divine as female is not part of many culture, in which God, if at best is neutral, in some culture, God is even defined as him. So, and even culture that say God is neutral, still in writing use him instead of they or it or other ways. So I think it's really important to be kind and acknowledging of the beauty of human culture, all the mythologies and philosophy that come before us, but it's also very important to be loyal and faithful to your existential awareness as existence. We need to write in ways that are different because we are seeing existence in different ways. We now know that we no longer need to be excluding women or non-humans or humans that have not the perfect right skin or the perfect ethnicity. There is no such thing. We need to understand that we are coexisting, we are manifesting, and I think that in that sense, we really need to understand a biological element to the history of culture. And you're absolutely right. People could come from different bodily experiences. They are going to write in different ways. In that sense, we need to teach our students, our children, not only to study the history of writing through a specific embodiment. People who are male writing about what does it mean to be human, great. But there are so many other ways we can understand existence. Myself, when I was 17 years old, I've been writing since a very young age. And I realized that I was using the term I in male terms, in Italian, as many Roman language, when you define yourself, it has to be gendered. So it has to be female or male, or neutral. Mostly as a human, you are taught to define yourself as female or male. So I realized that when I was writing, and I was 17 years old enough, or 16, I realized that I was writing in male terms. So I as male, and it's not because I saw myself as male in any way. And I started to realize why I write poems as with an eye that is male. And I realized that until then, all the people that I studied, all the poems, all the poets, all the philosophers, all the artists, every single person was male. In that sense, I started to, for a couple of years, only to read women's writers and philosophers and authors and painters. And I really delved into the history of culture from a perspective that was not what I was given, as beautiful as it was, because there are amazing philosophers and writers that are made beautiful. But I realized that it was a very specific point of view, and I was not exposed to so much more. And that so much more it means to be human. We are a plurality. We are not only one. We are never one. I'm not one right now. Think of our guts, all the biota that is living in us, all the microbes, the bacteria that is living with us and make us healthy. We are never one. And we've never been one. We are rivers, we are oceans, we're constantly changing. So teaching young children who only think from a specific perspective, as male, Hindu, Christian, Muslim, it's not a good way to have a society that is coexisting harmoniously with each other. Yes, you should teach children the values that you believe in, as much as you also teach children to recognize diversity and not imposing on them any strong identity. And I see, as a mother of a young child, how these formations are pushed in young children at the very young age, and how young boys are given guns to act like they're killing others, and young children that are female are given dolls to play like their mothers. Those are cultural diseases. We're talking about disease. There are biological disease. There are cultural disease. I think that pushing young minds to want to be something, hopefully could even something good, but we have even like, pushing young boys to be violent at a very young age, or pushing young female to see themselves as mothers, I think that's wrong. I think it's a cultural disease. And I think we need to be freedom, and we need to be kids, the freedom to see the beauty in everything and everyone, because they are already like that. They see everything as possible. They see themselves as everything. So thanks again for your beautiful question.
Thank you. We have just time for one more question, the last one perhaps. Manali, will you ask a question? Manali Chaudhuri. Are you there, Manali?
Yeah, I'm here, Rohitda. Yeah. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
Hello, Dr. Ferrando. I'm absolutely enthralled by your, discussion and your concepts. Actually, I just have a little curious, question. During the formulation of the society, there was something called a social contract theory. Now, when you're saying that we have to, exist in cognizance with the rest of the environment, is post-humanism actually trying to forge a concept of environmental contract theory, where everybody is, you know, sacrificing a part of one's individuality to be a part of a greater whole, so that there remains a balance between who we are and who, what the environment will stand at for posterity.
Well, what a wonderful question, Manali. Well, thank you so much. It's awesome. All right, so let's talk about this. You're absolutely right. There is this theory, the social contract theory, according to which once you are socialized, you most likely are going to silently approve of the society you are in. Because if you think about it, most people are not asked to sign anything to be part of a society. If you are born in India, you become an Indian citizen. If you are born in Italy, you become an Italian citizen. And you are supposed to silently accept the society. There are some exceptions. They say that someone is going to become dual citizen. Some countries allow that. So if you become a citizen of another country, most likely in the country, they are going to ask you if you're okay with the rules of the country. And you most likely have to say yes, unless you have to prove and explain why you're not okay with some rules of the country. Now, you are absolutely right in saying that once we have this notion of social contract, we can actually play with it and actually reconfigure this kind of social contract, because we could have a society in which we are educated to understand that to be part of a society, we need, for instance, to acknowledge non-human others, to acknowledge the importance of ecological awareness, to acknowledge the importance of human diversity. So you're absolutely right. What we have, which is, should we maybe mute again? Because I hear also a lot of, should we do the muting again and unmuting? Do you mind, Azizit, to mute? And fantastic. Perfect. So you're absolutely right. We can play with this notion. We can reconfigure this notion. This is why posthumanism is really extremely precious. And is absolutely not something that is, for me, they can just stay in the ivory tower of academia and just writing for a niche of people who become accustomed to that kind of language. It has to be a language that is thriving, that is changing the human experience, and that is changing society. In the sense, I would love to see a different understanding of the social contract, because the social contract itself is a type of contract that myself, I would not approve of that. If I'm giving the social contract of many societies at the moment, I would say, you know what, I don't approve this kind of social contract in which human-centric and anthropocentric is given as granted, in which the rights of many humans are not recognized. I do not approve of that social contract. So I would like to bring the social contract more into visibility. Maybe young children discussing what does it mean to be a citizen of a planet? Because in the end, we are not just citizens of countries. Because if Italy or India, United States are doing something that is very ecological damaging, it's going to damage everyone. Think of the Amazon forest, which is one of the lungs of the planet Earth. Think of the ocean. Think of the plastic that has been thrown there from so many countries, and how much is damaging marine life for all of us, for everyone. So in that sense, I think it's really empowering to see posthumanism as a frame that can change not only us as individuals, and it should, because it can, but also us as a society, us as a planet, us as a species, us as part of a species. And because we are part of a species, because we are bringing waves of change, of conscious, of awareness, we can change the species. It have to start with us, of course, individually. By that, it's going to change. We're bringing change to society, and by that, it's going to change the species. But you're absolutely right. The social contract has to be redefined, cannot be just thought as something that is silently accepted, should not be accepted, because most of the social contract are asking you to accept human centrism, they're asking you to accept, sexism and racism that is happening in so many societies. We need to redefine that social contract in clear ways, acknowledging with kindness and love, but clarity, with a lot of clarity. Let's be together and re-envisioning education and re-envisioning politics from a way that is really deeply rooted in this understanding of post-humanism, post-anthropocentrism, and post-dualism. So thank you so much, Manali.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ferrando, for being this phenomenal force and answering all our questions. It was lovely having you here. And now may I request my colleague, Anisha Sen, Professor Anisha Sen, to give the vote of thanks, please.
Thank you. So that was a lovely session. And it is my, I want to take this opportunity to offer my heartfelt thanks to all those who made this session a successful one. Learning cannot stop even in a pandemic, and I think this enriching session just showed us the way. So on behalf of the Heritage College, I would like to thank our esteemed speaker for the day, Dr. Francisca Ferrando, for her valuable time and enlightening words. I would also like to thank Dr. Roshijit Dutta, Head of Department English, the Heritage College, for facilitating the discussion so well. This session would not have been possible without the unending support of our Executive Director, Sri Prabir Roy, and our CEO, Sri Pradeep Agarwal. Our beloved Principal Sir, Dr. Pushpita Ranjan Bhattacharya, has been there throughout to encourage us and help us in all possible ways. A session like this needs active technical support, and for that, we are indebted to Mr. Debashish Kormakar and Ms. Shuhashini Chaudhary for their guidance. I would also like to thank our joint registrar, Dr. Kavita Shastri, for her cooperation, and my colleague, Dr. Rituporn Roy, for setting the tone for today's session. I appreciate the cooperation of all the faculty members, support staff, our beloved students and academicians who have shown an interest and graced our session with their presence. Thank you all.